through you, Mr. President. If the sponsor, would you please yield for some questions?
Senator DeFrancisco, do you yield to a series of questions?
Yes, I would.
Senator Krueger.
Thank you. So this is a one-house resolution. How much money is it adding to general fund expenses compared to the executive budget?
Financial plan that I handed to you moments ago indicates that the all funds budget, the executive has $142,706,000,000 in executive budget receipts, and then the adjustments are shown in that first column. And the state estimates receipts at $142,927,000,000. And you can see that's all funds, and we have the same computation for state funds, state operating funds, and general funds. And then there's an estimate, or there's a summary in the executive budget spending, same situation, what the executive spends, what our adjustments are, and what we spend. So what it really boils down to, if you take a look at it, is that we spend on an all funds basis the all funds spending is $137.4 billion, an increase of 1.5% over fiscal year 2014.
Mr. President, if the sponsor would continue to yield.
Yes.
Senator DeFrancisco yields. Senator Krueger.
How much money is added in your one house bill for K through 12 education?
K through 12 education, approximately $811 million. I think the governor had added something like 500
on top of the, on, you know, 811 on top of the governor.
11 on top of what the governor put in the budget.
Through you, Mr. President. If the sponsor would clarify, so this one house resolution has $812 million additional beyond what the governor put in for K through 12 public education?
Correct. If you include the pre-K dollars, you include gap elimination dollars, if you include all the dollars that go into education, and that would be 830, what is it, 811 million over the governor.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to yield.
Sponsor
yes.
yields.
The second page of the chart I received shows net adds in education of $252 million. So I'm a little confused how we're getting to the over $800 million. Perhaps it is because of the UPK, and many of us are delighted that we are all now committed to fully funding UPK. But where in the resolution do we actually have those dollars, since I'm only showing a net add for education of $252 million? On the chart I just received from my colleagues.
It's what I said before. It's the adds to education funding, mostly the GEA restorations, and the rest is the commitments on pre-K and also after school programs as well, which I would consider part of that as well. So. That's where it comes from. That's where the spending is.
Okay. Through you, Mr. President, for the record, I would love if that was true. I just don't see the numbers here on these charts. The One House resolution.
Senator Krueger, are you on the bill, or would you like
no,
to?
No, I have more questions. Thank you. How much money is there for the increased TAP proposal, which increases maximum TAP, I believe, from 5,000 to over 6,300 per student? Where would I find the increased money for the cost of that.
Ed section of the resolution, and I'll get it in a moment.
And just how much is being assumed to be available for that?
First of all, it goes into effect next calendar year, and
January 1, 2015?
Excuse me, I'm looking for the section of
sure.
the budget. The resolution, I mean. Where is it in the resolution? Page, that's not it. My page, that I'm looking at, is a different page number, but 27. The Senate concurs with executive proposal of $87.7 million, state operations, aid to localities. But then we go into the Senate advances language to increase the maximum tuition assistance award from $5,000 to $6,470. And the income limit presently to get TAP is $80,000. It's now going up to $100,000. So that's one of the proposals on TAP. Now there's several other very important proposals dealing with higher education that if you want to talk about, fine. If not, I'll get to it at another time.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor will continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Thank you. There's also a proposal. I'm highlighting the proposals I actually like and I wish we had math for. We're going to increase the EPIC program, probably over doubling the population eligible for EPIC. EPIC is now approximately $114 million a year, but magically we can increase or over double the population eligible for only $2 million a year. How are we going to pay for all those people's EPIC with $2 million?
We can afford it because the Federal Affordable Care Act actually closes the donut hole, which saves money. So that helps us afford the additional benefits, which I think all of us are pleased to be able to afford our seniors.
Through you, Mr. President, the sponsor would continue to yield.
Sponsor yes. yields.
Well, again, my colleague and I often agree because I agree the American Care Act, the Obamacare actually offers all kinds of opportunities, but this One House resolution cuts out the funding for the health exchange, seemingly an attempt to kill Obamacare in New York State. So does he know that we're cutting the funding to continue running the health exchange, helping to ensure more people are on this program, hopefully decreasing our other costs, as he just described?
Yes, because in the governor's executive order establishing the New York State Health Benefit Exchange, number 42, one of the whereas clauses is, whereas the development and operation of exchange in New York will impose no cost on the state, but will be funded entirely with federal funds until January 1, 2015, at which time the exchange will be wholly self-funded, meaning that no state or county taxpayer dollars will be used for such purposes, and we take the governor at his word.
Through you, Mr. President. There's a number of revenue changes in this budget. We do away with the governor's proposals for circuit breakers for both owners and renters, but we change the governor's tax freeze proposal. One, I'm not going to ask why they did away with the circuit breaker. I'm very upset about it. But two, I'm very confused about how this new freeze will work. Is there any income eligibility requirement? Can millionaires get your credit?
The first of all, the way it works is it's different than what the governor proposed because it's a true freeze insofar as it doesn't just, it goes on beyond the 2 years. It basically, if the municipalities meet the requirements, what ends up happening is that the property tax is frozen and that any additional taxes that would have had to been paid by the taxpayer up to 2% would be paid by the state. And that would continue, provided that the municipality or the school district has a plan that the state must approve. The language is unclear as to who at the state would approve it, and that's why it's part of the negotiations. But the state would approve a plan either to consolidate, to use joint services, to operate more efficiently. And the other thing it does different, that we've had a criticism at some of the hearings and at some of our meetings back home, is that a lot of districts, school districts, and a lot of municipalities actually have done consolidation and efficiency efforts over the last several years. Those would count as part of their plan, and they would explain how they're going to go forward with that plan. So if you were an efficient district and you did a lot of things, you're not shut out by not doing more when you've already shown your good faith in doing it and that you're going to continue in certain ways to continue in that plan. So that's the way it works out. As far as the income level, it's $500,000.
For you, Mr. President, if the sponsor will continue to yield.
Sponsor yields.
Okay, so.
And by the way, that I think I mentioned to the, you were there when I mentioned to the Commissioner of Finance that it would be a nightmare to administer, but this $500,000 is the same eligibility as the STAR program, so it's somewhat consistent with what's being administered presently.
So again, like the STAR program, it's more regressive than the alternative models that were there before. Would this apply to renters? Would this apply to the city of New York?
No, it wouldn't.
And
I'm going to ask the members to please exchange through the chair. Senator
excuse
Krueger.
You, Mr. Excuse me, Mr. President. So, through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor would answer an additional question.
Sponsor yields.
It will not apply to New York City. It will not apply to renters because?
Mr. President, that's exactly what I was going to get into when you rudely interrupted our exchange. The reason is if you look at the numbers when you get to the education portion of the resolution, there are substantial funds to the city of New York for pre-K, for after-school programs, and the like. And the concept was we would want to have some type of regional balance. Those are things that the upstate people will have to pay for on their own as opposed to the state picking up. So we want to have regional balance in benefits going to each region.
Through you, Mr. President, for the record, this plan is to give money not to the local governments, but in fact to individual homeowners who are having trouble meeting their costs. In fact, the local governments, like the old plan that I think my colleague didn't like, will still have the obligation to try to meet their expenses without increasing their revenue. And unlike the education funds, those go to the governments, and these proposals either go to the taxpayer or don't. And in this case, they don't go to the taxpayers in need in New York City or renters throughout the state. So it's a little bit apples and oranges, not apples and apples. I'm going to speak on the bill because I know the hour's late and we have limited time, and I may have time to come back later.
Senator Krueger on the bill.
I always appreciate working with my colleague, John DeFrancisco. I wish this wasn't 12:30 at night, and that we had had more time than starting at 5:30 this afternoon to review this One House resolution. There's an amazing amount of unknown information. There's an amazing number of lines in the document that are concerns or modifications with no dollar figures or no even language explanation of what we might guess is meant. My other colleagues will be going into specific details. I attempted to highlight a few things. We are doing away with the circuit breaker, which I believe is the most popular proposal to ensure tax relief to those people most in need statewide. We've created a new freeze system, which sort of has all the problems of the governor's proposal, and I'm not at all clear that there are advantages. We promise TAP money to TAP students, but there's no money in this budget. We promise increases in EPIC, but it's not clear there's money to pay for that. We promise more money for education, but I have to say the numbers don't add up on my own colleagues' charts. And in fact, there is some information that there's more money that will be going to charter schools than to all the public schools in New York State, which means 3% of the students will get far more than the 97% of the students who are all desperate for education funds. There's very confusing revenue proposals beyond the tax freeze questions. There are a series of changes in how we structure our taxes, a whole series of new tax expenditures and tax reductions, a whole series of changes to our gambling proposals. And we won't do justice to any of this tonight. And in fact, I believe that if we had budget bills, because by the way, we don't have budget bills to back up any of these 55 pages of often one sentence description. If we had budget bills before us, maybe we could have a healthier debate about what's being proposed. But disturbingly, we don't have those on our desks. And I don't even believe they've gone into the computers yet. So I may have other statements later, but for now, I'm very disturbed about what we're missing in fact, even if there's a laundry list of everything everyone might like to see in a perfect world. There's just not the money for it. Thank you, Mr. President.